Welcome back, or welcome for the first time, to TM1 Bytes Weekend Edition, episode 11 of a series of tutorials on a new strategy game called Farm Manager 2018. Now, in previous episodes, we have looked at most of the things that you can do on a level 1 farm. Now, we haven't looked at every single specific. So, for example, we haven't raised every possible animal, not even close. We've only raised one animal, which is chickens, but they are representative of how a lot of the animals work. We have, however, covered the basic principles of everything that you can do on a level 1 farm, but now it is time to ramp things up a bit. As with many games of this type, what you can do and how you can grow and how you can progress depends on the buildings and infrastructure that you have. Now, as I discussed way back in episode 1, the key building in this game is the farmhouse, which we have up there. With a level 1 farmhouse, you can build only small fields. So we cannot actually get to that. Hang on a second. Ah, here we go. Upgrade the building. No, that's not what I want. I want to know what the limitations are at the moment, which I can't tell. Okay, so we can see that it was 50 by 50 meter field. That's the largest field that we can create at the moment. If we upgrade the farmhouse, however, we will be able to go to 75 by 75 meters. So why is that important? Well, it's not so much the farm area itself or the field area itself. It's going to take you longer to plow that. It's going to take you longer to cultivate it, to fertilize it, to spray it, and so on and so forth. But the overhead costs in terms of getting your staff down to pick up the tractor and then getting up to the field will be minimized. So provided you do it right, you will actually end up saving more time having one bigger field than having two little fields. So there's an advantage for a start. The most important thing about buying a second level farmhouse is that it can take you beyond this small block of land that we've got here at the moment. Now, surprisingly, one thing that you can do, regardless of the level of farmhouse that you've got, if we take a look at the buildings and we take a look at the factories, for some reason, all of these are actually open to you. So you can even go to a large slaughterhouse for some reason. You can go to a small juice factory. You can go to a juice factory. You would not go to one of the larger ones simply because when you are on a small block of land, you are never going to be able to produce enough juice to be able to offset, for example, at 431 florins per month plus the 520,000 florins. Because the thing is, take a look at that. It's producing tomato juice, so that could be useful for us. We could do a bit of value adding there. It's producing cherry juice? Seriously? Okay, and I'm not sure what the other thing is. I imagine that's apple juice. For some reason, we don't have oranges here. I think it's possibly because of the country that this game was developed in. They don't have a lot of oranges there. But the thing is, you're not going to be able to sustain that off two piddly little fields like that. It's two piddly little orchards. It would be completely impossible. You'd never make money off it. So the thing about the upgrade isn't that it necessarily gets you to produce bigger factories, because it looks like you can do that from the get-go anyway if you want to. But it gives you the additional space to grow crops that you can feed into those factories so that you can actually make a profit. So the other thing too is that because I've been using this as a demonstration farm to demonstrate all of the various characteristics of a farm and all the things that you can do, I have a very mixed crop here at the moment. We could possibly sustain one of these factories if we were dedicated to the production of just one type of good, but that's not the objective of this series. So, before you actually go and build a larger house, I do recommend very, very strongly that you make sure that you have gone through these building courses, which, here we go, Negotiation Techniques in the Building Industry Training 3. So I've already done the first two of them, and now I am on the third one. And that is going to save me, if we take a look at the list of courses in training, the one that I'm doing at the moment, which is always difficult to find because you can't sort these in any way. Anyway, take my word for it. Oh, here it is. Negotiation Techniques in the Building Industry Training 3 reduces the price of buildings by 30%. Now, if we look at the upgrade of that building at the moment, it's currently sitting at $320,000. Now, originally, it was 400,000, not dollars, sorry, florins. We use florins here. Okay, 400,000 florins. Once I get this course finished in 3 days, it will in fact be $280,000 because I'll get a 30% discount. That's 120,000 florins that you cannot afford to just flush and ignore. You have to do that. And yes, it does cost you money to get through those courses, but that will be more than repaid, because remember, you're not just getting the discount on the farm owner's house, you're getting it on every building that you create. And now that we're starting to expand the farm, that is going to be a lot of buildings. So I am actually not going to upgrade that until such time as I've got that certificate complete, and that will give me the 30% discount. In the meantime, it does appear to be spring again, so I'm going to get in there and start working on my fields. So I'm going to do some cultivating. Yes, I'm sure I want to destroy it. No, I don't want to destroy it, but what the heck. Cultivator, Darcy. Darcy has been released from purgatory. He is, after that bug that we saw in episode 10, finally he has been released, and so he can go back into a tractor, assuming that he's not too traumatized to get back into a tractor, especially the ETOS, which is where he was trapped last time. Over the winter, I have done a lot of work to upgrade all of my farm machinery, refurbish it so that it should be in much better condition. There's the beautiful Bella in the Riga, and she will be going up to plough the other colza field. We're going to try to do the same things we did last time and try to get two colza crops in. So that's the priority at the moment, to get those in. I'm going to start the timer off now. Now you'll notice that I have actually gotten back over 1 million florins. So the things that I did previously should have improved the profitability quite a bit. I'll actually step up the pace there a little bit. Too low a temperature, it doesn't actually affect anything at the moment. The changes that I made should have improved the profitability. Now that said, while we've been away during the last week, the third service pack has been released on this program. So they've fixed a lot of bugs, but they've also changed a few things. Now apparently previously beef was incredibly profitable, and they've wound that back a little bit. Now I believe that also the profitability that you can make off peppers and off the tomatoes and so on has also been wound back, which is not good news for us, because I was making quite a bit of money that way, as well as off the wind turbines. So it's still clicking up at a pretty reasonable rate. I do have the third service pack installed. One other thing about not this service pack but the next one, those of you who have seen previous episodes will know that there is this accursed thing where if you have space in your chicken coops, for example, you're going to get the "your animals are ready for breeding, call the inseminator" thing. Finally, I'll just pause that. Finally, they are going to put an auto inseminate button in the next patch. It's not here at the moment, but that's going to improve gameplay by an order of magnitude. Now they just need something to do something about the queuing up of jobs so that you are not constantly having to direct people to go up here. Now, why is not Bella up there? So Darcy's up there. Where's Bella? Oh, she's down there. Okay, so she's still getting the tractor. Okay, so hang on. No, that's Nathan. What's he doing? Why did Bella machines autofill? Except, oh, Darcy can go do that. In the meantime, Bella can actually go and fertilize that. So we have plenty of chemical fertilizer machines autofill, and away she goes. Okay, so we're going to be trying to do some tag teaming on that one. We now have the qualification. Now what I'm going to do next is I'm going to bite the bullet and do the big one, the annual agricultural school. It takes an entire year to do it, increases the quality and quantity of the harvest by 10%, so it'll make it well worthwhile, and gives all of this additional training. So I'm going to bite the bullet and do it. Reason I haven't done it before is, of course, that doing this blocks you out for a year, so you can't do any of the shorter courses, but I'm certainly going to do it now. Now we're going to do our building upgrades. So you can see that it's 280,000. Now what will happen, fortunately, the medium house does not take up any more space than the standard farm owner's house, and so that'll just be destroyed and rebuilt. So I've got the hoarding up around there, so we're all ready to go. The other advantage of doing the upgrade of the building is, of course, that you will now have auto trade every how often is it? Every week instead of every 2 weeks. So that means that you'll be able to shift off the things that have a short life expectancy, like chicken, eggs, milk, and so on and so forth, much more quickly. The level above this, you'll actually get to do it twice per week. So that's an important benefit as well. Now, before you actually buy any land, which we can't do yet because we've still got to wait for the house to be built, and I'll just speed that up a little bit. Okay, Bella is working this time. You need to plan out where you're going to go. So when I first started this series, I said, well, we'll probably head to the south, which is where the water is, and there is still a benefit to be gained from that. But the pump actually seems to suck groundwater up for a reasonable radius. So there's actually no real need for us to head for the water straight away. So what I'm going to do is expand both east and west. So I'm going to add additional fields over there, and I'm going to add additional greenhouses there. And then I'm going to have a couple of extra orchards over here so that we get some economies of scale there. And also that's going to be our farm animals area. Now, when you start expanding the farm, okay, we've got our new house built, so I might just pause it there. When you start expanding the farm, you have to think a little more carefully about the placement of your workers' houses. So originally I placed the workers' houses up here, right? And mostly the reason I did that was that I did not know at the time how much of this land I was going to need for agriculture, and I didn't want the workers' houses getting in the way. But there has been a significant disadvantage to that. So the greenhouse guys, the Green Thumb Brigade, have to come all the way down here. Bella and Darcy have to come all the way down here to pick up the tractors. So what I'm going to do is move some of these houses down so that they are closer to the places where the employees go to work. And when you're on a large farm, you've got to think about that, because you need to minimize the amount of time that it takes for your employees to get from the house to the place that they're going to work. We will take a look at moving workers from one house to another later on in the episode. But for the time being, let's purchase some extra land. And again, you do that by going up through here into the big book of knowledge, and just below building upgrade, we have buy land. So if you cannot fit into your current land, you can always extend your farm into the surrounding areas. The opportunity to buy additional land is only available if you own a host building on level 2 or higher. So we do now. So we just need to pass that one requirement to start to buy land. Now, fortunately, it's relatively cheap. We can buy the land in any of the four directions. So as I said, I am going to buy it, and I just realized that this is twisted round the wrong way, because the mini map, remember, is 90 degrees offset from the way we are usually looking at the map. So we are going to go, we regard that as being north, we're going to go east and west, and fortunately 36,000 is not bad for an extra block of land. So I'm going to buy that, and you'll see that now we have the option of buying any land which is bordering that new land that we have. So when I buy that one, which is to the west, or what we regard as the west, then that will mean that these blocks will become available as well. So I'm going to buy that one. That's a little more expensive at 58,500. I'm not sure why, but we'll buy it anyway. If I buy to the south, so it looks like the land prices go up. As you buy additional land, the land prices go up. Alright, that's something to bear in mind. So I was thinking of buying an additional block of land down there and just moving down towards the river, but if that's the way it's going to go, I don't think I'll do that, because I can't really use that land at the moment, whereas I know what I'm going to do with these two pieces of land. So, we've done that now. Now all we have to do is exit back out of there. Now, here's where there might be a little bit of a problem. Because the problem that I found in a previous playthrough is that once you're in, you can't actually get back out again, except, but no, I don't want to do that. Okay, so how do I get back out of here? Okay, right-clicking got me out of that, but it got me into a top-down view that I could not get out of. You've got to hold down the scroll wheel on your mouse while you're rotating the wheel, and that is what gets you the different tilt, which there's a little bit of an art to it, but you get there eventually. Okay, now what were we going to do here? We are going to have to actually do a lot, So what I'm going to do is just rotate that around a little bit so that I can see what I'm doing. So I have got that field fertilized. I have got that field not fertilized, so I shall do that. Machines autofill. Actually, what I might do is do all of these things in double time speed and then come back to you and tell you what I've done. What I've done is plant some colza up there, which is the usual sort of thing that we plan to do. We're planting some colza down there as well. Now, I have just bought a second seeder because once we get some fields over here, we're going to need some second seeders anyway so that we can have two tractors working at the same time. We do, in fact, have two tractors working, or did have two tractors working, because I've planted corn there, which, as you may recall, uses a different seeder unit. So I was able to have two of them working there. We have, this one still needs to be fertilized, so I've bought up some fertilizer, and I shall get Nathan onto that. That's fine, he can do that. And I've also bought in a couple of new garages down here. I bought a new second-hand tractor, which I am refurbishing at the moment, so it's under the process of renovation. And that way we're going to need to hit a lot more fields once we get this expanded out a lot more. And that's my intention there. So I'm going to autofill that, except we've actually got quite a bit of harvesting to do here. Autofill that, and I'm only going to put two in each warehouse, or in each greenhouse, sorry, because two will do. We certainly don't want Bella up there. Alright, so we've got fungus on there, so we can start spraying that with antifungus. Machines, autofill. Bella can go up there with the orchard sprayer and the orchard tractor. So we're going to get all of those covered in due course. Now, I hate doing that. I keep pressing the E key, and it's difficult to get it right back in alignment. So, D is what we want. D, not E. Okay, so I'm going to put up some road down here, and then I'm going to start putting up some new fields. Now, after this year, I'm going to blow these fields away and replace them with larger fields. But for the moment, we just need to get some new fields up. So what we can do here is we can just create a new field like that. Now, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to press the escape key. Because the thing is, I do actually want to make sure that I'm getting a road down there. Actually, I can probably get it off that other road. So if I expand that out now, like so, that's not going to work, is it? Because there's not going to be enough space for that road to go through. No, there's not. Oh, goody. Oh, joy. Oh, bliss. Okay, so it's a little bit more convoluted, but we can still put it up that way, and then we can put a road down there. The main reason for that is I want the tractors to be able to get across to it as quickly as possible. So we can just keep expanding out that way and put in yet another field. Now these ones we're going to have to go from the get-go. We're going to have to go and plough them and so on and so forth. We may not get a harvest out of them this year. That's probably... Oh no, I can put the extra greenhouses down there behind that. So I can expand that out as well, and probably go down there too. That's a smaller field than I'd like, but then so is that one. So we now have some pretty chunky fields operating. So, one thing that you might want to do is make sure that you have got the appropriate equipment. Now, we have three tractors. You notice that I bought a Riga last time around, and we're actually going to need some more tractor guys. The reason that I bought a Riga is that if we take a look at, there it is, the ETOS, it has power of 500, and that determines how much pulling power it has. The Riga has only 400, and you can tell from the individual equipment how much power it requires. So that requires 200. I have not found any single piece of equipment that requires 500. So the question is, why are you spending the extra money on? If I find anything that requires more than 400, then obviously I'll go for a Riga over an ETOS over a Riga. But I cannot see the point at this time of doing that. So we have those fields laid out, but we don't really have enough people to service them at the moment. Let's concentrate on getting these fields set up at the moment. So the colza is running, the corn is running. I'm going to want that as feed for my chickens. Planting is in process for that colza, and that one we can also plant. So we can choose. Well, the only thing we can plant is corn because we only have. No, I bought a second planter. That's why I bought a second planter. Okay, I'm going to put some wheat. I'm going to put it in there or not? No, I might put some buckwheat in there because that's closer to the beehives. What I will eventually do, autofill, is possibly increase the number of beehives, but I might also put some down there and put the greenhouses up around there. But we shall see on that one. Well, I just want to get those ones done at the moment. So what we can do here, we're actually still a little bit short on machinery. We're also a little bit short on staff. So he can go and plow that one. So essentially, that's what I'm going to be doing this first year. I'm not actually expecting to get a full load of crops in on that one because it's really too late in the spring. We might be able to make it. The other thing that I need to look at is we've got the Xena combine here. I think we're going to have to sell that and buy in a, what is it, the Roden? So the combines and choppers, the Roden combine. And the reason for that is that that can operate with a 9 meter header. So it's expensive. It would actually take up most of the money that we have. See if there are any used on the market. That one's in bad condition. It's still going to take half of the money that we've got. But yes, let's not worry about doing that for the moment. So that's one thing that I want to do. The other thing that I want to do is start relocating my employees, and that will take us through to the end of this episode, I think. And then in the next episode, we'll start looking at doing some secondary industry and processing of goods into later products. So we're going to go to the housing area, and again, note that the house for permanent employees now only costs us 21,000. So we have all of our tractor drivers. We're going to want them down here somewhere, and we're going to want the green squad also down here just near the greenhouses. So I'm going to put one house in there, and I am going to put another house right next door to it. So we'll move them down there, and that should be okay. So we shall just wait for those to be constructed. We'll speed that up a little bit. Just wondering if I should have left some space for some extra beehives. But I'm beginning to have some doubts about bees because they'll make you a lot of money during the summer and during the spring, but less so when we're talking about winter. So if we go over to production. Oh, sorry, no, it's going to be animal houses. So that is one thing. Training required. Okay, so with these increased houses, you have to actually do some training, which is what I am doing the annual agricultural school for. That's another reason why I want to leave that until the next episode. I just wanted to see whether we can, in fact, get larger bee buildings, but it doesn't look like we can. So it looks like we are stuck with just that one level of bee building. So that's okay. These buildings are now complete. Okay, so we can hire staff there. Now, the problem with this is that, and I'm going to slow that down again. The problem with this is that you can only move one employee at a time. So if we take a look at that, so for example, we want the green squad not down to that building, but down to that building. Yeah, therein lies a slight problem. Let's move the tractor drivers first, who are not living in that building. They must be living in this building. That is this building. That one. Okay, so Darcy, relocate. And then, because these have no names on them, oh, you can actually see it highlighting. As you select each building, you see that the building is highlighting. Otherwise, there is no way to distinguish between the two. So that's the one that I want Darcy in, because it's right next door to the tractors. So we shall move him, and then we shall wait interminably while it's doing I have no idea what. Thank you. We'll move Bella. Relocate. So you can see that there's now a third one. That's because we've now cleared a space in that first house. So Bella can go down there. And then the third one is Nathan, who can also go to the same house. Oh, he's actually ploughing, so I can't move him at the moment. So we have any green thumbs in here. The beekeepers are okay because they work just down there. So we'll leave them where they are. The green thumbs, on the other hand, will relocate down to that one. The houses show up in the order that you built them. And then you have to wait a little bit while he comes out. There's no green thumbs in there. The green thumbs are all in the other one. Okay, so Benjamin Donald, you get the idea. I think you would find it exceedingly tedious if I was to take you through this one at a time. So that's how you move the employees around. So what have we covered in this episode? We have covered, first off, the fact that you should always do the building course before you start expanding your little empire, because otherwise you are going to pay through the nose for the level 2 farmhouse. Once you have bought the level 2 farmhouse, you can then buy land. So we have bought 2 blocks of land on either side, and we have also found that as you buy more land, the price of the land increases. The third thing that we have found out is that, well, we haven't actually found it out, is that when you start expanding, you are going to have to need to think about, first of all, what machinery you're going to need. So we were looking at the Xena and deciding whether we need to go to a Roden, which unfortunately we can't afford at the moment, but we will have to do that because it'll take extra power to chop through those fields once we get them all into production. You're going to have to think about the placement of your employees so that they're not traveling hither and yon. This is going to become a very sizable farm over time, so you need to get your employees relocated to where they need to be. Oh, one other thing too. I just noticed something. Sell 8 chickens. I'm going to take that because, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah, that'll do. It's like, if you're going to get that bonus, why not? That was not apropos of the subject at hand, but 6,100 florins. I'm not going to knock that back when our balance is now down at 339. Yes, we talked about the number 3 patch that came out and how there are going to be differences in the game in terms of how much money you're making off certain crops, but also the upcoming patch, which is finally going to get rid of the your animals are ready for breeding thing. And that was it, I think. The benefits that you'll get from having the larger fields, the auto trade increase, and that's the core to it. So we've set ourselves up now. We're not going to make a bonanza profit this year because it's going to take a while to get those fields into production, but we are ready to start expanding. And the next thing that we'll be expanding into will be down here into animals and also into producing a little bit more in the way of processed goods. So, if you enjoyed this episode, if you got anything out of it, would be greatly appreciated if you would click the like button, subscribe if you'd like to do so, comment if you would like to do so, but that is your bite for this. What time will this be going out? 6 o'clock Saturday morning, Australian time, I think. Have a great Saturday, and goodbye.